Good morning. Thank you for being with me today. I'm Regina with PrayerCommunicationWithGod.com, and I am honored that you have decided to be with me. Today, I had originally planned for us to start a new journey, a new study. I had planned for us to look at honor, but God's postponed that for a little bit. Here we are. A week before Thanksgiving, and we all have something to be thankful for. But today, my heart goes out to those who are on the journey of grief. You see, over the last few years, I've had several friends who have found themselves thrust onto this journey. And for those who's ever walked it, you know how hard the holidays can be. So, as we approach Thanksgiving, let's remember those that are on this journey. They are thankful, but they are also experiencing so many emotions that are just bombarding them all at one time, that they're just kind of going through the motions. So I ask you, as we approach Thanksgiving, as you reflect on everything that you're thankful for, that you say a special prayer for those who are on this journey of grief, that they will, at this time, feel God embracing them more than any other time in their lives. Because grief can be a very lonely experience. A very, very lonely one. So as we go into today's lesson, I want us to turn to the Book of Ruth. We're going to look at Ruth chapter 1. A portion of chapter 3. And Ruth chapter 4. Typically, when we explore the Book of Ruth, we focus on Ruth. And how she chose to leave her family and stay with Naomi. But today, I want us to look at Naomi. So as we read today's scriptures, pay close attention to Naomi. Let's begin. Now it came about in the days when the judges governed that there was a famine in the land. And a certain man of Bethlehem in Judea, in Judah, went to sojourn in the land of Moab with his wife and two sons. The name of the man was Elimelech, and the name of his wife Naomi. And the names of his two sons were Mahlon and Chilion, Ephrathites of Bethlehem in Judah. Now they entered the land of Moab and remained there. Then Elimelech, Naomi's husband, died, and she was left with her two sons. They took for themselves Moabite women as wives. The name of one was Orpah, and the name of the other, Ruth. And they lived there about 10 years. Then both Mahlon and Chilion also died. And the woman was bereft of her two children and her husband. Then she arose with her daughters-in-law that she might return from the land of Moab, for she had heard in the land of Moab that the Lord had visited his people in giving them food. So she departed from the place where she was, and her two daughters-in-law with her, and they went on the way to return to the land of Judah. And Naomi said to her two daughters-in-law, "Go, return each of you to her mother's house. May the Lord deal kindly with you, as you have dealt with the dead and with me. May the Lord grant that you find rest, each in the house of her husband." Then she kissed them, and they lifted up their voices and wept. They said to her, "No, but we will surely return with you to your people." But Naomi said, "Return, my daughters. Why should you go with me? Have I yet sons in my womb that they may be your husbands? Return, my daughters. Go, for I am too old to have a husband. If I said I have hope, if I should even have a husband tonight and also bear sons, would you therefore wait until they were grown? Would you therefore refrain from marrying? No, my daughters, for it is harder for me than for you, for the hand of the Lord has gone forth against me." And they lifted up their voices and wept again, and Orpah kissed her mother-in-law, but Ruth clung to her. Then she said, "Behold, your sister-in-law has gone back to her people and her gods. Return after your sister-in-law." But Ruth said, "Do not urge me to leave you or turn back from following you. For where you go, I will go, and where you lodge, I will lodge. Your people shall be my people, and your God, my God. Where you die, I will die, and there I will be buried. Thus may the Lord do to me, and worse, if anything but death parts you and me." When she saw that she was determined to go with her, she said no more to her. So they both went until they came to Bethlehem. And when they had come to Bethlehem, all the city was stirred because of them. And the women said, "Is this Naomi?" She said to them, "Do not call me Naomi. Call me Mara, for the Almighty has dealt very bitterly with me. I went out full, but the Lord has brought me back empty. Why do you call me Naomi, since the Lord has witnessed against me, and the Almighty has afflicted me?" So Naomi returned, and with her Ruth, the Moabitess, her daughter-in-law, who returned from the land of Moab. And they came to Bethlehem at the beginning of the barley harvest. Now let's flip over to chapter 3. And let's look particularly at verse 11. "Now, my daughter, do not fear. I will do for you whatever you ask. For all my people in the city know that you're a woman of excellence." The marriage of Ruth. We're going to look now at Ruth chapter 4. "Now Boaz went up to the gate and sat down there. And behold, the close relative of whom Boaz spoke was passing by. So he said, 'Turn aside, friend, sit down here.' And he turned aside and sat down. He took 10 men of the elders of the city and said, 'Sit down here.' So they sat down. Then he said to the closest relative, 'Naomi, who has come back from the land of Moab, has to sell the piece of land which belonged to your brother Elimelech. So I thought to inform you, saying, buy it before those are sitting here, who are sitting here, and before the elders of my people. If you will redeem it, redeem it. But if not, tell me that I may know, for there is no one but you to redeem it, and I am after you. And he said, I will redeem it. Then Boaz said, on the day you buy the field from the hand of Naomi, you must also acquire Ruth, the Moabitess, the widow of the deceased, in order to raise up the name of the deceased on his inheritance. The closest relative said, I cannot redeem it for myself, because I would jeopardize my own inheritance. Redeem it for yourself. You may have my right of redemption, for I cannot redeem it. Now this was the custom in the former times in Israel concerning the redemption and the exchange of land to confirm any matter. A man removed his sandal and gave it to another, and this was the manner of attestation in Israel. So the closest relative said to Boaz, buy it for yourself. And he removed his sandal. Then Boaz said to the elders and all the people, you are witnesses today that I have bought from the hand of Naomi all that belonged to Elimelech and all that belonged to Chilion and Mahlon. Moreover, I have acquired Ruth the Moabitess, the widow of Mahlon, to be my wife in order to raise up the name of the deceased on his inheritance, so that the name of the deceased will not be cut off from his brothers or from the court of his birthplace. You are witnesses today. And the people who were in the court and the elders said, we are witnesses. May the Lord make the woman who is coming into your home like Rachel and Leah, both of whom built the house of Israel, and may you achieve wealth in Ephrathah and become famous in Bethlehem. Moreover, may your house be like the house of Perez, whom Tamar bore to Judah, through the offspring which the Lord will give you by this young woman. So Boaz took Ruth, and she became his wife, and he went in to her, and the Lord enabled her to conceive, and she gave birth to a son. Then the women said to Naomi, blessed is the Lord, who has not left you without a redeemer today, and may his name become famous in Israel. May he also be to you a restorer of life, and a sustainer of your old age. For your daughter-in-law, who loves you and is better to you than seven sons, has given birth to him. My friends, Naomi, the name means pleasant. She was a pleasant woman. And then the most horrible thing happened. She lost her husband, whom she loved dearly, and she lost both of her sons. She felt as if everything had been stripped away from her. She cried out, God, what have I done? Why have you punished me in this way? Why are you against me? Why have you taken everything that I loved from me? But you see, she lost a lot. She became embittered. And that's why she said to the women in Bethlehem, why do you call me Naomi? Call me Mara. Call me bitterness. For the Lord has afflicted me. As a mother who has experienced the loss of a child, I can't imagine any greater pain. The laws of nature tell us that we're supposed to go first, not our children. Our children are our heritage, our inheritance. They're supposed to live long lives. And so as we are in grief, we find ourselves asking why. Why has this happened to me? What did I do to deserve it? Why, Lord? And very seldom do we ever learn why. We never know what that reason is. Not here, not in this earthly realm. Why is a question that the accuser of the brethren places in our mind. And he has it on loop where it plays over and over and over. No amount of reasoning in the world can give us the answer to that question. The question why in grief is a form of torment. Form of torture. It's a hell here on earth. My friends, your loved ones don't want you tormented. They don't want you placing on yourself garments of guilt, garments of shame. They don't want you to go through the, I should have done more. I could have done more. You couldn't. It wasn't meant for you to. That wasn't your assignment. Everyone who's created is created with an assignment. You're created to solve a problem. You contain solutions within you. Having said that, I want you to realize, though, you're not designed or assigned to solve every problem for everyone, including your loved one. That one that you've lost, they knew how special you are, how loving, how kind and compassionate. As you walk this journey and as you come into these holidays, which normally are thought of as a joyous occasion, don't lose yourself to bitterness. It's hard, and it's a really thin line between just walking through grief and stepping into bitterness. But today, you can honor your loved one by choosing to continue to love. By choosing to continue to be compassionate. Unresolved grief, grief not experienced, not dealt with, grief buried and pushed to the side, is a prison. I know. I walked in it for 25 years. And I became very introverted, very disconnected from others. I don't want this for you. As you're experiencing this time, you have many people encountering you, many people loving you, many people that want to help, and don't know how. They say things they think is spiritual. It doesn't help. Sometimes it makes you mad. Just because something sounds spiritual in your head doesn't make it spiritual. Some things are just better not said. But know that even when they make the mistakes of saying things that probably should have never escaped their lips, they think they're helping you. They don't know how. They've never been trained. But you'll survive this. Be honest with them. If words that they say in hopes of bringing you encouragement hurt you, tell them. They need to know. You don't tell them to put shame or guilt on them. You don't tell them to hurt them. You don't tell them to lash out at them. You tell them to help them. You know, when your child does something wrong, you steer them back in the right direction. And as hard as this time of grief is for you, in a sense, you are a teacher. You teach others what things help you and what don't. But you teach them through speaking up. In this time of grief, you're kind of having an identity crisis. Because your identity has changed. You're not the same person you were before this tragic loss. It's okay. It's uncomfortable. It hurts. It's confusing. And you feel like you're losing your mind. But you're not. You're not. You'll survive this one step at a time, one breath at a time. There will be days that it feels like you have taken 2 steps forward and 15 backwards. Recognize those 2 steps forward, because that's process. When all feels hopeless, recognize that dim light that's on this journey with you. It's guiding you through it to the other side. You can survive this. And you see, Naomi thought she lost it all. But she had Ruth. Ruth said, I'm not leaving you. Your people shall be my people. I love your son so much that I am honoring you. You raised your son to be loving and kind. You taught him that. And that is still within you. Even though you're going through this horrible loss, that kindness, that love, that compassion is still in you. It's a part of you. It's who you are. It's who you taught your son to be. And so your people are my people, and your God is my God. And I'm with you every step of this journey. You're not alone. You're not going through this alone, because I'm not leaving you. I'm not walking away. I choose to be with you. And it is in that choice that hope came to Naomi. In a sense, Ruth was Naomi's rescuer. God placed her there for just this time. And he's saying to Naomi, I haven't abandoned you. I love you. Life is hard. You experience valleys and peaks, but I'm with you every step of the way. You're not alone. It feels like you are, but I'm carrying you, and I'm placing people in your path that will help you along this journey. We cry and we mourn tonight, but joy comes in the morning. So, my friends, I just want to pray for those of you who are experiencing the throes of grief today. And I want you to know you're not alone. I'm here. Message me, call me, email me, respond to me on Twitter, whatever, however you can get in touch with me. I'm here. I'll share with you my experiences. I'll cry with you. I'll listen. And I'll tell you, it's okay. It's okay to be angry. Don't stay in that anger. Walk through it. But you can't go above it. You can't go below it. You can't go around it. All you can do is face it head on. Each of these emotions that are rushing at you, all you can do is face them head on. And when you do that, you don't get stuck. You're progressing to the other side of this journey. Let's pray. Father, I come to you this morning with a heavy heart, a heart heavy for those who must experience the journey of grief. And who must experience it now in these holidays. When we are hurt, it hurts even more sometimes to see others experiencing joy. Sometimes we just want them to feel what we feel so they can understand. If they're not on the journey with us, experiencing the same loss, they have no understanding. I just ask you to embrace each person on this journey today. Wrap your loving arms around them. Whisper in their ear, you're not alone. I'm carrying you. I know it's hard, but I've got you. I'm carrying you. I too lost my son so that you may have a life without sin. So I know the pain that you're experiencing, and I'm here to guide you. Love on them, Lord. Feel these deep, deep holes that loss has left. Fill it with love and compassion. Allow them to experience comfort and peace which surpass understanding. Allow them to experience your presence. When we lose someone, Lord, we miss their presence. We miss them being there with us. So I ask you, let them feel your presence, your peace, your comfort, your understanding in a world that There is no understanding. Allow them to feel your love and your compassion. Bring to them joy now. Comfort them in their time of sorrow. And just love on them. When we lose someone, it feels as if we've lost that love. But Lord, you and I know that's not true. We were blessed to have that loved one in our lives and to be able to experience that love. Lord, allow them to feel that love again. Allow them to feel that love again. All these things I ask, in Jesus' holy name. Amen. Thank you, my friends. May God bless you. May God be with you. May His favor rest upon you. I thank you for being with me today, my friends. And I just want to once again mention my book that I've got here, A Journey into Understanding. And if you're seeking understanding, then I encourage you, stop by Amazon.com and order your copy of this book today. Order one for your family, for your friends. Seek His wisdom. Seek His understanding. In this book, I share with you the things that He has taught me over this past year. I share with you areas of healing that I have received, both physical and spiritual, as well as financial. And these are there for you as well. I share them with you to encourage you, to help you, because as Revelation 12:10 says, we have the blood of Jesus, the blood of the Lamb, and our testimony. We are overcomers by our testimony. So I encourage you today, if you haven't already gotten a copy of this book, reach out there, order you a copy of it, and write in. Let me know how it's helped you. Let me know if there are other areas that you want my help with, because I'm available. I'm here. I'll gladly be your mentor. I'll gladly share with you the many things that He is teaching me along this journey. As I journey into understanding, as I seek His wisdom and His understanding. God bless you.